For anyone who hasn't heard of the Miss South Carolina competition, it's a tradition meant to give young Southern women a role model of talent, beauty, and intelligence. Still, how did this competition go from being a small local pageant with three competitors to a televised annual show featuring women from every county? And more importantly, what of the first Miss South Carolina? What was her experience, and what was her attitude towards the pageant? These were questions I never bothered to ask my grandmother as a child. I didn't know much about the competition at all, much less what it meant to have a relative that is a local celebrity. Still, as time passed, I started noticing articles and even merchandise surrounding the Miss South Carolina contest, and I began to feel proud of my grandmom's accomplishment. It then occurred to me that I really wanted to know more about this woman, whose life was supposed to be an inspiration to others, and I realized that others should want to know about the life of the first person that exemplified the qualities that would be treasured in Miss South Carolina. So I give you the testimony of the first Miss South Carolina herself, Miss Wayring Smathers Knight.
My name is Wayring Smathers Knight, and I was the first Miss South Carolina. And I was born in a family of girls, and my sister and I were just a year and a half apart, and we looked like twins. So I started dancing and singing from the time I was about 6 years old. And we did what you call a sister act. And my mother loved to take us places and let us do things. And she played the piano real pretty. So we really grew up as dancing sisters. We looked like twins. We weren't very far apart. And so we lived in Greenville, and we finally settled in Columbia, South Carolina. And from then on, we took dancing, and we would go on floor shows, and Mother would go play the piano for us. I remember when I was little, Mother took us to a small town, and this is when we were young, and she had taught us a song and dance and played the piano. And we went to Charlotte and got on the train. So we had upper berth. So my sister and I slept in the upper berth, and we were little then. I guess I was about 7 and she was about 6 and a half. So we got to ride in the upper deck, upper berth of the sleepers, you know. Boy, we thought we were something. We had the cutest little pajamas, and and the rest of the people were up there too. So we got to Charlotte, and we gave a floor show in Charlotte, North Carolina. And so after the floor show was over, my sister of Virginia, she and I got out there and danced with all the big men. We had the best time. So we had a lot of good times, and Mother and my father took my sister and I to New York, and we danced up there. And back then, we went on to be on television. Was quite a feat in Columbia. So we used to go out to the new television stations and sing and dance. Anyway, that's the way it was. I was Miss South Carolina when I was 17 years old. Went to Atlantic City. It was a lot of fun in Atlantic City when I went up there. It was the boardwalk then, and you would ride down the boardwalk in these, I don't know what you call them, push carts, I guess. They would get, some man would push you, you know, and you would wave to the crowd and had your name all on the outside of the thing and everything. So that was quite thrilling. And I remember smiling so that when I got back to the hotel, I had sunburned around my mouth where I'd smiled such a long time. My night to be up on stage, I sang, you won't believe it, but I sang "The Love Bug Will Bite You If You Don't Watch Out." And then I could do toe dancing and I could do acrobatics. So I thought, well, an acrobatic toe dance would be real good, and I could do all those flips and things and land on my toes. But really, that didn't go over. A girl did a plain old tap dance one. And I could tap dance better than anything else, but I just thought it would be something different. But the tap dance, the girl that won, did a tap dance. So, didn't get too far there, but I enjoyed the trip and everything. Back then, the stage was out over the water, so it was really pretty out there. They don't have it like that now, I don't believe. They might still have a dock or something where you go out. But anyway, we had a real good time up there. And I remember I came back to Columbia wearing an ankle bracelet. That was the newest thing then. And everybody at Columbia High School wanted to know what that was and where I got it. And so the next thing I knew, everybody was buying ankle bracelets. So I brought it back to Columbia. And I was going to go to Carolina. But in the meantime, I met my husband, who was on the switchboard at Carolina. And his roommate was dating my cousin that went to Columbia College. So he said he would introduce him to Miss South Carolina. And he did, and so I met him as a blind date. And from then on, we went together. And I didn't finish school until February of the next year, and I decided I was going to go to Carolina, because he had finished Carolina. And he said, no, don't you go to Carolina. If you do, we'll never get married. So I said, well, I won't go. So I got married when I was 20 years old. And he was a school teacher. Was teaching school in a little country school. And he wasn't making much of anything. And he was the principal of the school, too. And in the meantime, I went on to a commercial college. On the side, I'm the only one that didn't graduate from the University of South Carolina. I went to Columbia Commercial College. So I went to work for the government, you know, as a stenographer. Well, it got to the place I was making more than he was working for the government. So he said he wasn't teaching school any longer. And he went to the board and told them that his wife was making, she didn't even have a college education after. She was making more than he was making. And he wasn't going to, he didn't like that. So they raised his salary, but it still wasn't as much as I was making. So he quit teaching school. He taught about 2 years. And he started selling automobiles, and he loved selling automobiles. But in the meantime, we bought a house, and I worked right on for 5 years. And I said, well, I'm going to work for 5 years, and then I'm quitting, and I'm having my family. So in the meantime, we had accumulated a nice little brick house and a decent car. So he went from he went into the Army. And when my first baby was born, he was overseas. I didn't work for 17 years, but I did teach dancing, and I did take my children, two little girls. They were 3 years apart, but they started taking dancing when they were as young as when they could walk. And I taught dancing over at the McCullough School of Dance for about 9 years. It wasn't a full-time job, but in the meantime, they would go everywhere Mr. McCullough was the one that owned the school, and my two girls would go with them and do floor shows. They used to do that. They don't do that anymore like they used to. So they did a lot of dancing too. But I really enjoyed teaching. I taught children from the time they could walk. At 3 years old, you can imagine. But they were so cute, and I was real patient with them. They could learn. We both were working before we both retired, and went down to the beach and took the youngest daughter with us, Kathy, and went looking for beach houses. And we found one we liked so much at Garden City, and it was right on the inlet and about a block and a half from the beach. So we looked at several, and finally Kathy said, I don't want to look anymore. I said, take you down to the beach. Said, I like that house. So sure enough, we bought that house, and we've had, oh goodness, I don't know when it was, She was a teenager then. She's about 50-something now. And we really enjoyed it. And I was still working. I worked till I retired, and he worked till he retired. So my husband and I started taking trips through Florida, and we've been to Disney World I don't know how many times. And I really enjoyed traveling. We went on all these bus trips. He had a heart attack and got to the place he couldn't take these trips and drive. So we had a church bus that went on a lot of trips, and we started traveling. One time we were gone this was with the University of South Carolina traveling trip. We were gone for 2 weeks, and we went down one side of the United States and up the other. It took us 2 weeks to do all that. We used to go out to the Officers Club in Columbia. My husband, he went to OCF, and he was an officer, and we would go out there and take about a table of 10 people. And he couldn't dance very well, so he came home one night and asked my youngest daughter, Kathy. He said, "I want you to teach me to dance." So she did. She taught him to twist back then when they were doing the twist, and she taught him to dance. And so from then on, he and I danced together because, see, he couldn't dance. He didn't like to dance when we got married, but can't stay in a dancing family very long and not learn. So up until the time he died, we had one table out there with 10 people and a good orchestra. I've been married 62 years. It would be 63 this year. And had a good marriage. Never boring. For a long time, I went to the Miss South Carolina contest every year. Went in Greenville, South Carolina, and then it went to Spartanburg, South Carolina. And of course, I had to pay my own way and everything. So when it got to Spartanburg, I said, I don't think I'm going to go over there. And they said, "You've got to. You're going to be the Grand Marshal." And I said, "Grand Marshal? I've never been that in my whole life." So I said, "I got to go." So I went, and sure enough, they had us in those little Volkswagen, and John was in. They didn't have a back seat, so they sat me up on the top, and by the side of the thing, they said, "The first Miss South Carolina, 1937. And those people said, you know, I could see them and see what they said and see them wave. They said, "We can't believe it. You're so pretty." So that was real. That was something I probably wouldn't have done almost every year we would go back to the Miss South Carolina. And one year I went back to Greenville and stayed the whole week and went on every night on the stage, and they introduced me as the first Miss South Carolina. So I've had a right glamorous life to have a lot of experiences. But I haven't hit on half of them.
Miss Knight's family look at her more as an inspiration than a celebrity. She's been like a second mother to her grandchildren and has always been there for her husband and especially for her daughters, Kathy Clark and Patty Shelley.
Me and my sister Patty, we're 3 years apart. And in the meantime, my aunt Virginia, her sister, married a man, Glenn Day. And so there the two sisters were married, one to a night and one to a day. And they proceeded to have 2 kids each. Mom and Dad had 2 daughters, and Virginia and Glenn had 2 boys. And that was kind of a funny thing that Ripley's, believe it or not, got a hold of that. And they had an article in the paper. They used to do a weekly or daily article, Ripley's, believe it or not. And Mom and Dad and Virginia and Glenn got in there, and they said that it was how funny it was that two sisters, one had married a night, one had married a day. One had 2 boys and one had 2 girls. So that, somewhere we still have that article. But my sister and I, Patty and I, started doing a sister act too. And we went around and danced around the city and did floor shows and sang and tap danced and proceeded to go on to take other kinds of dancing. And Mom likes to tell that Patty and I danced in New York City, which we did. And I think Mom and Virginia danced in New York City too. So that kind of continued on from Mom and Virginia to me and my sister. And I don't know, I'll say a few things about my father. He has recently died in October of this year. And I like to remember the really good things about him and part of his personalities and his personality. He was a hardworking man. He never had less than two or three jobs at a time when they were raising me and my sister. He worked so hard because we were not rich at all, but we felt like we were because we weren't. There were very little that they wouldn't do for us or try to do for us, and he did that because he just wanted to give me and my sister the best he could give us. And my mother went back to work too to do that. But he was very hardworking, and he loved his family. And Daddy used to tell a story about he played intramural basketball. And he would, one time Mom came to the game to see him, and he got so excited and so nervous that he went to go for the basket, and he went straight ahead and almost knocked himself out on the wall and hurt his knee. And I think for years to come after that, he had a knee problem showing off for my mother. A long time ago, they invested in a beach house at Garden City on the inlet. It was a $45,000 house, and Mom went back to work, and they worked really hard together to make payments on this house and the house in Columbia. And finally, before he died, he had years and years of having that house paid for and owning that house, and he was so proud of the beach house. And in fact, that's where I am right now. And he loved his beach house, and he loved making shell mirrors. And but he had a sense of humor, and I saw it not as much as I wish I had. I know at one time at the church, he and Mom were very involved in their Sunday school class, and they also loved the Sunday school class. But way back when I was a little girl, they did a womanless wedding, and I remember this. Daddy put on a blonde wig, and he was the jilted lover, and he went running down the aisle to stop the wedding, and he had a handkerchief, and they had it drenched with water so that when he wrang his handkerchief out, the water just came dripping down. Those were his tears. But I remember that. He would do stuff like that, and he would put wigs on to make my kids laugh, and he would put a clown nose on to make my kids laugh. And my mother says, and I can't imagine this, but she says as they got older, they would go on trips, on these bus trips with the senior citizens, and Daddy would get up at the front of the bus, and he would get the microphone, and he would tell jokes, and he was a stand-up comic. And my mother told me that, and he said, "Dad, your daddy just loves, all the women just think he's just great, and they just laugh at his jokes." And so one year I bought him, for Father's Day, I bought him a book of jokes. Of course, they were clean jokes. They were jokes that Daddy would tell to help with his routine. When my sister and I were younger, the Miss South Carolina thing was not a big deal. My mother kept it. She was kind of shy about it. She kept it in the background. And I remember, though, as kids, she had a trophy, and my sister and I loved to play with that trophy. And I'm thinking back on it, it did finally break, and maybe we broke it, I don't know. But Mom threw that away, and I wish to this day that she had gone ahead and kept it. We could have had that fixed. But anyway, she did have a trophy, and she probably, from what she says now, I know she didn't get a crown when she won Miss South Carolina. She had a ribbon, and we still have that went across her chest when she wore her bathing suit. And we found out recently that she was given a key to Atlantic City from the mayor of Atlantic City. And we found that recently. I didn't know she had that. It was the key to the city that was presented to Mom and the other contestants when they were there vying for the Miss America in Atlantic City. So we have several mementos like that, and of course we cherish them now, but at the time, like when we were kids, we just played with them. It wasn't a big deal. The Miss South Carolina thing did not become a big deal until 1987, and they had their 50th anniversary pageant. At that time, they were holding it in Greenville, and as I said, Mom was really shy about it. She was not want to brag, and we never bragged about it, but in 1987, they really were into the nostalgia thing, and they wanted to find the former Miss South Carolinas. They wanted them, as many as could come to Greenville to be in the pageant and really take part in the pageant for the first time. They searched Mom out, and we talked her into it. She decided to go ahead and just get out of her shell and start and take part in this. It was a big deal. I mean, at that time, Dawn Smith was Miss South Carolina, and they interviewed Mom. Dawn and Mom got to be somewhat friends. We went out and we bought Mom two formal gowns because she was going to be on stage. She actually one time introduced Dawn Smith. And then the Saturday night when they had the finals, Mom and the former Miss South Carolinas who had come to the pageant all got to be out on stage. And at that time, they all had crowns, and I don't know which ones of the first ones did not have crowns. Mom did not have a crown. She had to borrow a crown to wear on stage. But she looked beautiful. We had gone, like I say, and bought new gowns for her, and she looked beautiful, and she looked so elegant. And it was just a great thing. And like I say, it had been kind of pushed under the rug, but all of a sudden she was this big celebrity, and people were going around, and they were wanting her autograph, and it was so much fun for us because we were just, and Holly and Nancy, my daughters, just thought that they just had the celebrity for a grandmother. I mean, it was the first time that they had been exposed to that at all, and it just was really special for them. Another thing about the Miss South Carolina pageant, it kind of after 1987, there were years that went by, and they would write to Mom and you know, try to get her to come back, and she wouldn't come back. Well, I don't know what year it was, but it was years later when they moved the pageant to Spartanburg. They were going to have a parade down the streets of Spartanburg, and they wanted my mother to be Grand Marshal of the parade. And, oh, that, we were so excited. We talked her into that, too. And so we went to Spartanburg, and my daughters and myself, we stood and up at the top of the hill and waited to see Mom come up the hill in a BMW convertible. And they started off the parade. They had a band, and the band was first. And here comes the Grand Marshal of the parade, which was my mother. And my kid's grandmother, she looked beautiful. She had a pink dress on, and she just looked so pretty. And she's sitting on the back, like you see beauty queens, on the top where the convertible top is folded down. She's sitting up there waving to the crowd. My father is sitting in the passenger seat, just beaming with pride. I mean, I just cried when I saw him coming up the hill. And Mom said, and she was nervous, but she was really getting into it about halfway through the route. And she said that people would look at her and wave and say, "Hey, Miss Knight, oh, you don't look that old." And she just really just had a ball doing it. And it's a real special memory for me because I remember it was just Daddy was so proud of her. And one more thing that I need to mention about my father. He was very, very proud of the fact he and Mom were married for 63 years, and it would have been 64 the end of May. He was very proud of that, and he should have been. There are not many people that make it that long in a marriage. I'm so glad that my daughter, Nancy, has decided to do this film about my mother. I have told more about my mother because I think this is a tribute to her. She is still alive. And she's 84 years old, and she's lived a very full life, and she has earned this film. She's a gracious lady. She's helped me and my girls so much. I can't thank her enough, and I wanted to do this for her, and Nancy did too.
Holly Clark, granddaughter.
One of the things that I can remember personally when my mother had to go back to work, and she needed somebody to take care of my sister and I. She would leave us with my grandfather and my grandmother during the day, and so that they could take care of us while she was at work. And we had a lot of fun with them, and we had, of course, another thing, all the trips we would go on together. I mean, we went to, goodness, Disney World with them, I remember, and we had a good time there, and they've also taken us to the mountains, and we went up there, I remember, to see I think my Uncle Hoyt, and there's so many things that I can remember. I know that with my grandmother personally, I of course remember when she went up to the pageant when she for Miss South Carolina, and I think it was in Greenville, which in 1987, I believe. They taped her doing the pageant, and we just thought it was really neat because seeing her as almost like a celebrity, she was given so much attention, and because she was the first Miss South Carolina, of course. And I remember that was just really neat because we did think of her as sort of a celebrity because she was getting all this attention, and it was just a lot of fun for her, I know personally, being involved in that, getting so involved in that. She really enjoyed that, and there's just so many more memories that I could come up with about my grandmother and the time she spent with us.
Every person is a celebrity in their own way, and every story can be inspirational to those privileged enough to hear it. Miss Knight's story is meant to be an inspiration since she was the first to earn the title Miss South Carolina and will always be an example to follow to those who know her.